There, okay? And here's what they had, so that's same thing they had, right? Okay? All right, what's next?
Number 15.
Okay, Landon, number 15?
Oh, wait.
What?
Was the ability to create is 1 plus 1? Yeah, that was 3.
Well, then, I'm on a different one, I'm gonna practice this, I guess. The one.
I thought you were just trying to.
Go ahead, yeah.
Number 16, then.
Number 12?
Yeah.
Okay. On Unit 2, Test 2? Unit 2, Test 2?
Yeah.
Have you done Unit 2, Test 2?
Yeah.
You did?
Yeah.
How come I don't see a?
Then 16 is the one I meant.
And then, same, I think.
Yes.
Yes, give me an A on it.
You might play, because I missed.
Okay.
I missed 12.
What's this doing? Come on.
Is this?
Well, it's stalled out, maybe it has a problem here.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't have, are you sure you're not looking at the practice test or something? And you submitted it?
It says test.
Yeah, I don't have one for you. Yeah, bring it up. I'm curious. So I'll use, Ashlyn, you said it was your number 12?
Yeah.
Okay. What? What?
Guess I got 100.
Okay, I guess you did. Let me refresh it and see if it's.
Did you get that?
Oh, yeah, I didn't get the.
Oh, there, now it showed up. Okay, I guess, I don't know. When I refreshed it, it was stalled out, but I got it. Okay. Okay. Number 12, you said? Okay. Yeah, that's a good one. I like this one. All right. Okay, what about this one? So how about this one? What are we going to have to do on this? What's our rule we're going to follow here?
Chain rule.
There's going to be chain rule, but okay, good, but in the outermost level, this is a product, isn't it, right?
Yes.
Inside the product rule, we're going to have to do some chain rule stuff, but it's a product of two functions. Okay, so then what are we going to get? We got the first, so e to the 3x times the derivative of the second. So now what's the derivative of the quantity 3x minus 1 to the 7th? Okay, so I get a 7 times to the 6th times 3, right? Because I've got the derivative of hand to the 7th is 7 hand to the 6th, but then the derivative of hand is 3. Okay, good. Plus the second factor, 3x minus 1 to the 7th, times the derivative of e to the 3x. So what's the derivative of e to the hand? E to the hand times the derivative of hand. You see that? Okay. So there's actually two layers to that one, aren't there? You got the derivative of e to the 3x is e to the 3x, but then the derivative of 3x is 3. Okay, so now what can we do here?
You get the 3 though?
I could pull out, let's try to factor out the greatest common factor, and there's gonna be several parts to that, right? There's gonna be the number part, and then I've got two different light bases here, don't I? So I've got the light base 3x minus 1, and I've got the light base e. Agreed? Okay. Well, actually, I can just take an e to the 3x out in front of the whole thing, correct?
Yes.
And I can take a 3 out in front of the whole thing. So I've got the common factor then, 3e to the 3x, and then what's going to be left behind when I do that? So from the first function, I'm dividing away the 3, I'm dividing away the e to the 3x, and I'm left with what?
7 times.
Okay, so I'm left with 7 times, oh, hang on, and then we're not done, are we? Then I've got that orange light base.
Yeah.
Now don't say anything out loud, but I want you to think about this. What's the power of the orange base that I can undistribute and factor out?
Six.
Okay, we agree. I take out the lesser power. So we could take out front then also a 3x minus 1 to the 6th. And now we got to figure out what's left behind. So we divided away the 3 from the first term, we divided away the e to the 3x, and we divided away all of that stuff, didn't we? Did you agree? Okay, so all I'm left with is what?
7.
Okay. So I get 7 plus, how about over here? So I divided that away, I divided that away, and I divided away this base to the 6th, so all I'm left with is just 3x minus 1 to the 1. Okay, and then all I've got to do here is just clean that up. Okay, so then we'd end up with 3e to the 3x times 3x minus 1 to the 6th. Times all this stuff. So what's all that going to be? 3x minus 1 plus 7 is just 3x plus 6. Okay, and really there's, I could factor what out of that last bit. Could take a 3 out. Okay. So then probably my best factored answer would be, if I take a 3 out of there, I'm going to get 9 e to the 3x times 3x minus 1 to the 6th times x plus 2. Okay? Everybody agree? And so here's the, let's see, this is published answer. Is that what we got? Yeah. Okay? All right. What else?
16.
Okay. So kinematics problem, right? They're giving us, the position function is given to us at the bottom. They want you to graph the position function. Okay, well, you have on this one, so you guys get on the test. I better make sure everybody understands. On the test, once you've opened up one of those calculators, you know, you can go back and use that tab again. It opens up as a new tab, and so if you go on the Chromebooks, I think you just go down to the little Chromebook symbol and click on it, it's there available, right? So once you've gotten to them, they're available. So the graphing one is kind of a non-issue, right? I mean, I'm assuming everybody can graph it anyway, because we could just find the zeros, and I mean, you can all graph a problem. But you have the graphing calculator available anyways. B through E are the ones that we want to focus on. So it says find and graph the velocity function, okay? So let's do that. So what's B going to be then? So we got differentiate, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to get 8t minus 3.
Yeah.
Okay. And just a line. When is the object stationary? Okay, so when is the object stationary? That would be when velocity equals what?
Zero.
Okay, so that's going to be at 8/3? 3/8. Well, it's 3/8, yeah. All right, if I set that equal to zero. When is it moving to the right? That's going to be, so moving to the right is when? That's going to be when velocity is what?
Positive.
Okay, velocity is positive, then that's movement to the right. Negative means it's movement to the left. So that's when V is greater than zero. Moving to the left is going to be when V is less than zero, right? So then all we got to do is we just have to, you know, we have to set our velocity function, and that's no big deal. We're just going to set our velocity function greater than zero and solve that. So T is just going to be greater than 3/8 for this part. And then over here, if I do the same thing, I'm just going to get T is less than 3/8 if I set the velocity function less than zero and solve, right? Okay, questions? Okay. Determine the velocity and acceleration of the object at T equals 1. So for part C, well, I can, V of 1 is 5. I got to calculate acceleration, but what's acceleration? Derivative of velocity, which is 8. So A of anything is 8, right? So on that one, we're getting 5 and 8. Okay? Determine the acceleration of the object when its velocity is 0. Well, that's, the acceleration of the object is what?
8,
no matter what. The velocity is 0 at 3/8, so we could plug that in, but it doesn't matter. It's constant anyway. So 8. And here's probably the hard part. On what intervals is the speed increasing?
Yeah.
Okay. So the speed is increasing when, once again, what are the criteria for the speed increasing? The velocity and the
acceleration
have to have the same sign, right? So the invisible hand is pushing in the same direction as the motion, right? That's going to increase the speed. If the invisible hand, meaning the direction of the acceleration, is pushing against the direction of motion, slowing it down, right? Well, the acceleration in this case is always positive, agreed? So the only time when the speed could be increasing is when the velocity is also positive. When's the velocity positive? T is greater than 3/8, right? And I guess we're limited. Our domain only goes up to 4, right? So I should probably include those in the, really this shouldn't be T is greater than 3/8. It really should be, what should that be? It should be this answer really should be 3/8 up to 4, right? And this answer really should be 0 to 3/8, right? And so when is the speed? Is the speed increasing? Speed would be increasing only on the interval where both velocity and acceleration are positive. Same sign, which would be on the interval when velocity is positive and acceleration is always positive. Okay? Questions? Okay? All right. What else? All right. How about this one? That's not the one?
Mine is e to the negative x times square root of x.
Oh. That must be your other attempt. Let me, here, I'll get it. That's fine. Okay. That guy. So what's the rule going to be here? You have your product, isn't it? I've got something times something, function times a function. So we've got each product here. So we got the first times the derivative of the second. Well, square root of x is x to what?
1/2.
Okay, so then the derivative of x to the 1/2 is 1/2 x to the... Okay, good. Plus the second, so x, we'll call it x to the 1/2, times the derivative of e to the minus x. So what's the derivative of e to the hand?
E
to the hand. Times the derivative of negative x is... There you go. Okay. And so now if we just clean all that up, what do we get here? So I get a first one's going to become just an e to the... Take your pick here. I mean, we've always done all the way through is we've always just tried to factor out stuff, right? So let's do that. But you could also just make two fractions and get a common denominator. Either way. So if we factor stuff out, I could factor out a 1/2, right? I could factor out an e to the minus x. And I've got two different powers of x to the minus 1/2 and x to the positive 1/2. So I'd factor out negative 1/2. I'm going to take the lesser of the two, right? Factoring out least common factor. So x to the minus 1/2. And then what's left behind? So from this first one, we factored out the 1/2, we factored out the e to the minus x, and we factored out the x to the minus 1/2. So what are we left with? I'm left with nothing, all right? Am I?
You're left with an x.
Where's the x?
Because you have an x, you can have an x in the negative. So you still have an x.
You mean over here, you mean?
Yeah.
No, I'm talking about the first term.
Oh, no, nothing.
Well, but nothing means?
One.
Yeah. Everybody agree? Right, I divided all that stuff away, so I'm left behind with the 1. Okay, the second, now over here, now I agree, over here we've got, if I factor out a 1/2, that means I'm dividing by 1/2. So what am I going to get here then? -2, right? Because, and here's why, right? Because -1 divided by 1/2 equals -2, right? So I get a -2... from this stuff, that's divided away, and then x to the 1/2 divided by x to the minus 1/2 is going to be x. Okay, so then we end up with, if we just combine all this stuff, I've got an e to the minus x, so that goes on the bottom as an e to the x, I've got a 2, I've got a square root of x, all that's on the bottom, and then this is the stuff that's on the top, 1 minus 2x. Okay? Right? But just to prove my point here, you know, I just want to make sure. We could have also just made these two fractions and combined them, right? This first one would have just been 1 over 2 e to the x times radical x plus, over here we would have just had, it would have been a minus, wouldn't it? So I've got a negative there. Minus e to the x goes to the bottom, and I've got a square root of x up there. So to get a common denominator, what would I have to multiply the second fraction by? Top and bottom? Got a 2 and a square root of x. Right? And then that gives me my common denominator of 2 e to the x radical x. And on the top, I've just got a 1 minus 2x. Okay? Make sense? And they don't, like, they don't mark it wrong if you leave a square root on the bottom, right? Yeah. I mean, we don't worry about that stuff. Okay. Yes?
So, just trying to, like, bracket, I think I got lost in this. Mm-hmm. Where did the -1 at the very end of the...
Okay, that came from when we were doing our product rule, right? We got two parts. We got the first factor. So there's factor. Whoops. Factor 1 times factor 2, right? So we had the first factor times the derivative of the second, which is just, you know, x to the 1/2 is 1/2 x to the minus 1/2, plus the second factor times the derivative of the first. What's the derivative of e to the u? The derivative of e to the u is e to the u prime. So the negative comes from the u prime. The derivative of the negative x is a negative 1. Okay? That make sense? Okay. Any others? Okay, nothing else?
Actually, can we do the 11?
Sure. Oh, yeah. Okay, this is a good one to look at. Okay, so this is one where... I mean, this could be pretty difficult, or it could be really easy, depending on whether you use the properties of logs first, right? If I just follow the rules, the derivative with respect to x of natural log u is u prime over u, right? Well, u prime is a mess. I mean, u is a quotient, right? So if I were just to power through that, I'd have to do my quotient rule on the top and then divide that by this rational function. And there's a fair amount of algebra to do with, right? Easy to make a mistake. But we could make this a lot easier because what do my properties of logs tell me about the log of a quotient? The natural log of A over B. Yeah, it's the difference of the logs, right? So then we could rewrite this as the derivative with respect to x of, instead of this complicated log, it's just going to be the natural log of x plus 1 minus the natural log of x minus 1. And now if I differentiate term by term, that's a lot easier, right? So that's going to give us the derivative of log u is just u prime. Well, what's the derivative of x plus 1? 1 over u minus derivative of x minus 1 over x minus 1. Right? And then all I would do here, if I want to combine those, is just get a common denominator. Right? So I could multiply this one through by... x minus 1 over x minus 1. And multiply this one by x plus 1 over x plus 1. And then I'm going to get, if I multiply straight across, x minus 1 over x minus 1 times x plus 1 is?
X squared minus 1.
Good. Minus, and then same thing over here, I'm going to get the quantity x plus 1 over x squared minus 1. So I've got a common denominator of x squared minus 1, and on the top I'm going to get x minus 1 minus the quantity x plus 1. So x minus x cancels, negative 1 minus 1 is negative 2. So there it is. And it might even...
You can put it in just like 1 over x.
Just that part? I was wondering. I don't think you even have to simplify it beyond that. Could have just left it as 1 over x plus 1 minus 1 over x minus 1. Okay.
I did it in the 4 over x squared.